This is the VOA Special English Education Report. Students in Washington, D.C. return to classrooms in August to begin a new school year. But at least 5% of their teachers did not return with them. In July, the District of Columbia Public Schools told 206 teachers that they were not good enough to stay. The school system in the nation's capital dismissed 75 teachers in 2010. It was the first year of a new teacher rating system. Experts say such large numbers of dismissals are rare in American schools. But in Washington, the rating system is not governed by the labor contract with the teachers' union. So school officials have more freedom. The system is called impact. Teachers are observed in the classroom 5 times a year for at least 30 minutes each time. They are also judged by student test scores. Administrators rated 65 of the 206 teachers as ineffective. The others lost their jobs because they were rated minimally effective for a second year. Emily Cohen at the National Council on Teacher Quality, a private research group, praises the impact system. This is an evaluation instrument that is finally able to capture who is highly effective and who is ineffective, and who could be doing better and could use some assistance. Most evaluation instruments in the country do not capture teacher performance. All teachers are rated satisfactory. Some Washington teachers say their ratings depend too heavily on test scores. For some teachers, half of their rating is based on how well their students do. But Emily Cohen says testing is probably the most objective data that we have on teacher performance. The district is also looking at other things, she says, so it's not just looking at student test performance. Teachers with the highest rating can receive a bonus of up to $25,000. In addition, they can receive a pay increase. Almost 60% of the teachers who were rated minimally effective in 2010 stayed in the school system and improved. School officials say these teachers received help to become better. The Washington Teachers Union says impact unfairly hurts teachers who work in schools with high rates of poverty. The Washington Post reported that most of the teachers with the highest rating work in schools with lower poverty rates. For VOA Special English, I'm Carolyn Prasuti. For more education news and to learn American English, go to voaspecialenglish.com.
This is the VOA Special English Education Report. John Wooden died in June at the age of 99. He was one of the greatest 20th century Americans in sports. He was an excellent college basketball player. He led Purdue University to a national championship in 1932. After college, he was a high school coach. He also taught English for 9 years. But where he really made his mark was at the University of California, Los Angeles. He was head coach of men's basketball for 27 years. His teams won a record 10 national championships. These included 7 in a row during the late 1960s and early 70s. The Bruins have won just one other championship since then. He coached famous players like Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, known then as Lew Alcindor, and Bill Walton. Several years ago, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar spoke at a ceremony honoring John Wooden. He said, "Many top athletes worry that they will be exploited for their skills by their coach." But that was not the case with John Wooden. The coach was praised for how he taught the basics of the game, like passing, defense, and moving without the ball. But he also offered life lessons as a speaker and author. His books included The Self-Improvement Guide, Pyramid of Success. At a speaking event when he was already in his 90s, he explained that his father had taught him a few things about success. He said, "I was raised on a small farm in southern Indiana. Dad tried to teach me and my brothers that you should never try to be better than someone else. Always learn from others, and never cease trying to be the best you can be. That's under your control." Those words later helped him with his own definition of success. He said, "Peace of mind attained only through self-satisfaction and knowing you made the effort to do your best. I believe that is true. If you make the effort to do your best, trying to improve the situation that exists for you, I think that is success, and I do not think others can judge that." His wife of 53 years, Nell, died in 1985. At UCLA, the man known simply as Coach had a record of 620 wins and 147 losses. Current coach Ben Howland calls John Wooden the greatest coach in the history of basketball. And that's the VOA Special English Education Report.
This is the VOA Special English Education Report. The International Baccalaureate Organization was founded in 1968. It works with schools in 143 countries to offer programs for students age 13 to 19. These programs, it says, help develop the intellectual, personal, emotional, and social skills to live, learn, and work in a rapidly globalizing world. The organization says IB programs are in more than 3,000 schools. The majority of these schools offer IB diploma programs. High school students have to complete 6 courses, pass exams, and write a 20-page paper to earn an IB diploma. The courses are in humanities, science, arts, math, a second language, and their own language. Students can also attend special events. Recently, more than 300 IB diploma students from 13 countries attended a conference at the University of British Columbia in Canada. The 5-day conference was called The New Sustainability, Making Things Better, Not Just Less Bad. The students heard from professors, graduate students, activists, and others. One of the speakers was Drew Deutsch, director of IB Americas. He says the conference was meant as a way for students not only to learn about the environment, but also to develop lasting relationships.
He says conference organizers want to send the students back to their schools to deal with issues related to protecting the environment. But he says they want these students to become students of the world and to form bonds with peers their own age from around the world. He adds that with social networking and other tools, these relationships can last a lifetime. 17-year-old Itzel Chavez is a student at the International School of Beaverton in the American state of Oregon. She was one of 21 IB students who received scholarships to attend the conference. She said, "I applied for a scholarship and I had to write an essay. Her school chose only one person and she got to attend." She says the main speakers would describe a sustainability program or tell how a special project improved the environment in their community. Then the students had to choose a project to present to the conference. Itzel worked on a video. It asked students three questions about sustainability and how they would make it happen in their own communities. After the video, group members went on stage to tell what they themselves would do to protect the environment. For VOA Special English, I'm Alex Villarreal.
I'm Carolyn Prasuti with the VOA Special English Education Report. March 1st was the 50th anniversary of the Peace Corps. President John Kennedy began the program in 1961. The Peace Corps sends American volunteers to provide technical assistance in education and other areas in developing countries. Amanda Pease is one of almost 40 volunteers serving in rural schools in Sierra Leone. Ms. Pease teaches science at St. Joseph's, a high school in eastern Sierra Leone. She studied chemical engineering at the University of California, Los Angeles. She decided to serve for 2 years in the Peace Corps after she finished her degree. Peace Corps volunteers left Sierra Leone in 1994 because of civil war. But now they are back. Science teachers are in especially short supply. Efforts in Sierra Leone to get more children through primary school have led to crowded high schools. Amanda Pease is the only chemistry and physics teacher at her school. She says she has to work hard to get students more interested in learning. She says what she loves best about her experience is the magical moment when students understand a chemical process or ask her for more exercises. More than 8,000 Peace Corps volunteers are currently serving around the world. Volunteers become part of the community where they work and live. Travis Bloomling from Pennsylvania teaches English in a rural Indonesian community. He says learning English and at least having some knowledge of the language can help people when they look for a job or meet people. Mr. Bloomling's family expressed concern for his safety in a country where Islamic militants have sometimes attacked Westerners. But what concerned him, he says, was the thought that leaders in his village might not welcome him. But he says he could not have been more wrong. They have permitted him to enter their homes. He joined them in their Muslim meetings. He joined them while fasting. And he has even entered the mosque. In addition to Indonesia, Peace Corps volunteers in East Asia serve in China, Thailand, Cambodia, Mongolia, and the Philippines. For VOA Special English, I'm Carolyn Prasuti. If you have a Peace Corps story to share, go to voaspecialenglish.com, or you can post a comment on our Facebook page at VOA Learning English.
This is the VOA Special English Education Report. One job of an athletic trainer is to treat injured athletes. But does it make a difference if the trainer is male or female? Sometimes yes, if an injury or condition is a male problem or a female problem. Then athletes say they are more likely to want treatment by someone of their own sex. But what about a problem that could affect either sex, like a dislocated shoulder? Researchers at North Carolina State University asked male football players at two American colleges. The study found that those players would still probably choose a male trainer, unless the injury made them feel depressed. Then they would most likely choose a female trainer. The researchers offer two possible explanations. They say football players might be seen as weak if they talk about their depression with a male trainer. Also, over half the players described female trainers with words like caring, nurturing, and affectionate. The researchers say this shows that gender stereotypes have influenced the opinions of the players about women. They say the concern is that players might see the training room as not the place even for well-qualified women. The study, led by Heidi Grappendorf, is in the Journal of Athletic Training. Trainers are an important part of an athlete's life. But an organization based in California is working with coaches to help influence boys to show more respect toward girls and women. Pharos Moideen is director of the Coaching Boys into Men program of the Family Violence Prevention Fund. He says the nonprofit organization works with police, judges, teachers, and coaches. He says the group used $1.5 million donation from the Nike Foundation to expand the program to cricket players in India. He said they used the power of cricket coaches to educate boys about healthy and respectful behavior toward women and girls. Written materials are also being provided to other countries through UNICEF, the United Nations Children's and Educational Agency. Brian O'Connor of the Family Violence Prevention Fund says young men need guidelines in how to treat young women, in person or online. He says problems include unwanted or excessive text messaging or breaking into someone's Facebook account. He says this digital dating abuse has increased through technology. And that's the VOA Special English Education Report.
This is the VOA Special English Education Report. Last week, we told you about a program that trains women in prison to start their own businesses after their release. Today, we tell you about one of the few prisons in America that offer college-level classes, San Quentin State Prison in California. Judy Lewin volunteered to teach in the college program at San Quentin in 1999. She was a graduate student. The program had a small group of volunteers and no money. But a year later, the director resigned. Ms. Lewin agreed to run the program until a permanent director could be found. But once I started doing the work and got more deeply involved, I started to think more and more about what this program could become. The Prison University Project seeks to prepare men to lead thoughtful and productive lives inside and outside of prison. 20 courses are offered each semester. Classes offered this past semester included English, math, United States history, and Russian and Soviet history. Others included Asian American theater, Spanish, biology, sociology, philosophy, and criminal justice. 300 inmates take classes every semester. They earn credits toward an Associate of Arts degree in liberal arts from Patton University in Oakland, California. Ms. Lewin says getting teachers to volunteer is not difficult, although some are nervous about their first trip to San Quentin. She has recruited more than 150 volunteers, including graduate students from colleges and universities in the area. Charles Spence hopes to earn parole from prison one day. He needs a few more courses to receive his associate's degree, and he wants to earn a master's degree in psychology. He says, "This experience really has changed my life. It has given me a lot of tools on how to express myself. This program is really rare in the prison setting, so we are really lucky to have an opportunity to get an education, especially with the way the economy is out there now." More than 100 prisoners have received an associate's degree. Many more have continued their college studies after their release. The project receives no state or federal money. It operates with donations from people and foundations. Jody Lewin wants to keep expanding the college program at San Quentin. There is a long waiting list of prisoners who want to take classes. For VOA Special English, I'm Mario Ritter. For more programs and activities for learning English, go to voaspecialenglish.com.
I'm Alex Villarreal with the VOA Special English Education Report. The Southeast Asian English Olympics were held in February in Jakarta, Indonesia. High school and university students competed to demonstrate their English skills at the Anggrek campus of Binus University. The Bina Nusantara English Club at the university started the English Olympics in 2005. The yearly competition was formerly known as the Nationwide English Olympics. This year, the club invited other Southeast Asian schools to send ambassadors to join students from Indonesia. The organizers hoped to have 400 or more students take part. There were six areas of competition. One was based on Scrabble. This is the board game where players try to form words from letters with different point values. Other areas of the competition included speech, storytelling, and newscasting. Students were judged on their ability to present the news. Johannes Napis is the 20-year-old chief executive officer of the Olympics. He says the biggest event was the debate competition, which included international judges. He says the competition used the British parliamentary system, but debaters could use either British or American English. Organizers of the Southeast Asian English Olympics got support from the American Embassy in Jakarta and VOA. The finals took place February 19th in a new high-tech American cultural center called At America. It opened in December in the Pacific Place Mall in Jakarta. 100 Indonesian high school students came to the At America Center. They chose their favorite entry in the sixth area of competition, short movie making. But adult judges chose the winners of the gold, silver, and bronze medals. Johannes Napis says the Southeast Asian English Olympics might expand next year into the Asian English Olympics. He said people from Bangladesh and China wanted to take part in the Southeast Asian English Olympics, but they could not accept them. So, he thinks they have a good chance of expanding the competition into other parts of Asia next year. For VOA Special English, I'm Alex Villarreal. Our programs are online with transcripts and MP3 files at voaspecialenglish.com. You can also comment on this and other stories. And you can find us on Facebook at VOA Learning English.
This is the VOA Special English Education Report. We had a question from China, from a listener who wanted to know about John Dewey. John Dewey was an influential thinker and educator. The New York Times once called him America's philosopher. Larry Hickman is director of the Center for Dewey Studies at Southern Illinois University, Carbondale. He was not surprised that the question came from China. Mr. Hickman told us he just returned from 2 weeks of meetings in Beijing in December. He and Chinese educators discussed the close relationship between Dewey's ideas and those of Confucius. He also worked with a group of Buddhists who like Dewey's work very much because it goes along with some of the ideas of Mahayana Buddhism. John Dewey described his ideas in books including Democracy and Education, The School and Society, and How We Think. Mr. Hickman said Dewey was perhaps the best known philosopher, educator, and public intellectual of the 20th century. He was active in many fields, including education, philosophy, psychology, and humanistic and humanitarian affairs. He was an important influence in the founding of the American Association of University Professors and the American Civil Liberties Union. He was also influential in the founding of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, although he himself was white. John Dewey was born in Burlington, Vermont in 1859. He was influenced by the scientific work of Charles Darwin. He was also influenced by the work done with immigrant English learners in Chicago by Jane Addams. She was a social worker and the first American woman to win the Nobel Peace Prize. And Dewey was influenced by observing his own children. At the University of Chicago, he founded the Laboratory School. But Dewey would likely have disagreed with many current practices in American education, like the wide use of standardized testing. Larry Hickman said Dewey thought that testing had its place, but that testing should be more like medical tests. They should be testing for individual needs, interests, and abilities, and not to compare one student to another. John Dewey died in 1952. But Dewey scholar Larry Hickman says his ideas are still being taught in education schools. And that's the VOA Special English Education Report.
This is the VOA Special English Education Report. India was once a colony in the British Empire, but now Indian tutors are helping to teach math to some British children over high-speed internet connections. Early results suggest that online tutoring may improve student performance. But not everyone is happy at this so-called outsourcing of tutors. Students at Raynham Primary School in London gather at 3:30 for their after-school math lessons. Five time zones and thousands of kilometers away, their math tutors are also arriving for class. Each pupil gets an individual online tutor. The students work with activities on their computer screen and wear a headset and microphone to talk to their tutor. Their classroom teacher, Altus Basson, says he has seen an improvement in results. Children who struggle to focus in class focus a lot better on the laptops, he says. 9-year-old Samia Abdul Qadir says she enjoys the online lessons. It helps me because sometimes when we're doing it in class, I don't hear the teacher very much, and I don't understand, but online is better, she says. Her friend, Abdul Fadil Badouri, agrees. He says, online you can hear it. It's not shared by everyone. Everyone has different topics they are learning. Tom Hooper started the company that provides the online tutoring. The company is called Bright Spark Education. He says, children today feel very confident online. They feel very engaged. They feel very in control. And that's half the battle with education. Give them control, make them feel confident and enjoy their learning, and you'll see them start to improve and embrace it. Online tutoring costs between $20 and $25 an hour. An online tutor is about half the cost of traditional face-to-face coaching. But some people say an internet connection is not enough of a connection for teaching and learning. Kevin Courtney is Deputy General Secretary of Britain's National Union of Teachers. He says there's a really important emotional connection between a teacher and a child, whether it's a whole class or whether it's one-to-one. You need that immediacy of feedback, and we're not convinced that that can happen across an internet connection. In one of the wealthiest countries in the world, we think that we can afford to have teachers with the genuine emotional connection there with the children. Bright Spark Education says the online tutoring is used only as an addition to supplement regular teaching. The company says its service does not represent a threat to teachers' jobs in Britain. Some parents say they are satisfied with the results. And what about the children? Some say they love it. But at least one declared, "I hate maths." So math, or maths as the British call it, is still not everyone's favorite subject, even with the latest technology to teach it. For VOA Special English, I'm Alex Villarreal. You can watch a video of the online tutoring by going to voaspecialenglish.com. You can also find English teaching activities, plus MP3s, podcasts, and transcripts of our programs.
From VOA Learning English, this is the Education Report in Special English. Recently, we told you how some medical schools in the United States offer future doctors a way to finish in 3 years instead of four. Some law schools also offer a way to save a year. People who want to become lawyers traditionally attend 3 years of law school. Like medical students, many law students are deeply in debt by the time they finish their Juris Doctor or JD degree. Those who take out loans borrow an average of around $100,000. Almost all graduates must pass a state bar examination to get a license to practice law. New York University Law School professor Samuel Erstreicher thinks more students should be allowed to take the bar exam after 2 years of classes. This was more common in the past. Supreme Court Justice Benjamin Cardozo and President Franklin Roosevelt both took the bar exam after 2 years. Professor Erstreicher also suggests a more professional instead of a more academic program of study. Learning more about professional skills, he says, would better prepare a lawyer to serve the needs of average Americans. Some law schools offer a choice of a 2 or 3 year program. In 2009, Northwestern University School of Law in Chicago became the country's first top law school to add an accelerated program. Accelerated students at Northwestern have to learn the same material and pay the same price as 3 year students. Some lawyers argue against accelerated programs. They question whether many law firms would want to hire lawyers without that third year of law school. For VOA Learning English, I'm Carolyn Prasuti.
From VOA Learning English, this is the Education Report. Outdoors in the open air seems like a natural place to study natural science. It also makes sense in a place like Southern California, where people like to be outside a lot. Now, the Natural History Museum of Los Angeles County has redesigned an outdoor space into a living exhibit. The 1.5 hectare area used to include a parking lot. Now it welcomes birds, butterflies, and many other living things. Teacher Eva Eng has visited the museum's outdoor campus with her students. She says they enjoyed the experience. The children were learning about plant science in school. Museum scientists come outside to describe plants and insects in the natural setting of this outdoor laboratory. Greg Pauly studies turtles. He tells students how urban development has changed the habitat of turtles like the western pond turtle. He says these animals are happiest around small bodies of water that grow and shrink with the seasons. Today, with development, there is much more permanent water, like the pond at the Natural History Museum itself. The scientist says the changing habitat is one reason why western pond turtles are disappearing. In addition to science lessons, the open-air exhibit provides contact with nature in a way that city children rarely get. Landscape architect Mia Lair says children can get real-life answers to questions they may have. Outdoor classrooms help students understand how the natural world is interconnected and how living things need habitat to survive. Museum official Karen Wise says the whole museum is opening up to an indoor-outdoor experience. For VOA Learning English, I'm Laurel Bowman.
This is the VOA Special English Education Report. Professors have lectured for centuries. But how effective is lecturing to students compared to working with them? A new study compared two classes of a beginning physics course at the University of British Columbia in Canada. There were more than 260 students in each section. Both were taught by popular and experienced professors. The study took place for 1 week near the end of the year. One class continued to be taught in the traditional lecture style. The other professor was replaced by two teachers. They had little teaching experience, but received training in interactive teaching methods. The training was led by Carl Wieman, a Nobel Prize-winning physicist who leads a science education program. There was almost no lecturing. The teachers put the students in small groups to discuss and answer questions. The instructors always gave feedback after the groups did tasks, and they gave readings and quizzes to finish before class, so the students would come prepared to discuss the material. Professor Wieman says there was a great deal of data showing how identical these two large sections of the class were before the study. At the end of the experiment, both classes took the same test. Students in the interactive class scored nearly twice as high as those in the traditional class. Attendance also increased that week. Graduate student Ellen Chelou was one of the teachers. She says the methods they used are designed to encourage students to think like scientists. The study appeared in May in the journal Science. It seems to confirm earlier findings about lecturing to large classes. But some experts have criticized the way the study was done. Both of the researchers who taught the class, Ms. Chelou and Louis Delaurier, were also authors of the study. This could raise questions about whether their involvement might have influenced the results. Professor Wieman is currently on leave from the University of British Columbia and the University of Colorado. He is the Associate Director for Science in the White House Office of Science and Technology Policy. He says research has shown better ways to teach based on evidence about how the brain learns. And he hopes more professors will learn that how someone teaches may be more important than who does the teaching. For VOA Special English, I'm Alex Villarreal. You can find a link to the physics test that the students took at voaspecialenglish.com. I'm Alex Villarreal with the VOA Special English Education Report. The Program for International Student Assessment, or PISA, is a 2-hour test that compares the performance of 15-year-olds. In the latest test, the countries with the best readers were South Korea and Finland. But students in Shanghai, China, scored the highest of all in reading, mathematics, and science. The next strongest results were in Hong Kong, Singapore, Canada, New Zealand, and Japan. In all, around 500,000 students in more than 70 economies took the test in 2009. The test has been given every 3 years since 2000. Shanghai took part for the first time in 2009. The Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development released the results. Andreas Schleicher is director of the Education Indicators and Analysis Division at the OECD. He says Asian countries value education more than other countries. They have given education a priority. Every child, every teacher, every parent knows that education is the gateway to success. Mr. Schleicher says other education systems can learn from Shanghai. For example, he says education spending in the province has increased, including teacher pay and training. And administrators are putting teachers into challenging classroom situations to make them better at their jobs. In the PISA scoring system, Shanghai scored 600 in math. By comparison, the United States scored 487. Shanghai's reading average was 556. American 15-year-olds scored 500, the same as in Iceland and Poland. In science, Finland was second behind Shanghai. The United States was 23rd. Education Secretary Arnie Duncan says the results show an urgent need for Americans to do more to remain competitive in the world economy. He points out that the United States has fallen from 1st to 9th place in college graduation rates because of gains by other countries. Mr. Schleicher says international testing experts have investigated and confirmed the Shanghai scores. He says the PISA results are not representative of all of China. But he also says they dispute the common belief that Chinese education is centered on repetition and memorization. 25% of the Shanghai students showed advanced thinking skills to solve difficult math problems. The OECD average was 3%. For VOA Special English, I'm Alex Villarreal. This is the VOA Special English Education Report. Public schools in the United States have to be neutral about religion, even though they close for holidays like Christmas. The Constitution separates religion from government. Researcher Charles Haynes explains what it says. He says, Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. Those 16 words provide the framework for how we deal with religion in our public schools. Those words are part of the First Amendment, which guarantees freedom of expression and other rights. Charles Haynes is a senior scholar at the First Amendment Center, a group that studies free expression issues. In the last generation or so, different groups have encouraged public schools to celebrate diversity and cultural differences. At the same time, courts have ruled against any publicly supported celebrations of one religion over another. Charles Haynes thinks the schools are generally doing a good job. He says, "So public schools now, I think, understand that their role is to expose students to learning about different religions in a fair way, an objective way. Their role is to protect the religious liberty rights of students. If they want to express their faith, they may do so. But school officials under the First Amendment may not take sides in religion." Holly Jones teaches 6-year-olds at a public school in Loudoun County, Virginia. Each December, she has her students make posters about their own celebrations at home and present them to the class. The posters are discussed and then shown on the walls at the school. Ms. Jones says, "Some students will do Hanukkah, some Kwanzaa, some Christmas. Some we've had in the past do the Chinese New Year." Some children come from families with more than one religion. Holly Jones says the children always ask lots of questions about the traditions of other families. She says this gives them an understanding about how different and diverse the students are. And Charles Haynes says that is one of the purposes of public education in America. And that's the VOA Special English Education Report, written by Nancy Steinbach. You can find transcripts and podcasts of our reports, and you can post comments at voaspecialenglish.com. And you can find us on Twitter and YouTube at VOA Learning English.
From VOA Learning English, this is the Education Report. American librarians have announced their choices for best children's books of 2014. One honored book is the story of a squirrel and an imaginative girl. Another is about trains. Deborah Taylor is a librarian at the Enoch Pratt Free Library in Baltimore, Maryland. She has served on several award committees. She says the committees look for good writing and good storytelling. The American Library Association's John Newbery Medal honors the writing of a book. Its Randolph Caldecott Medal honors the illustration or pictures of a book. This year, the Newbery Medal went to Flora and Ulysses, The Illuminated Adventures by Kate DiCamillo. It was her second work to win a Newbery. Flora and Ulysses is a humorous story about a squirrel and a girl who live in a world both real and unreal. The Caldecott Medal was awarded to Locomotive, a book by Brian Floca. It has been praised for its technical understanding and explanations of how things happen on a moving train. Librarians also give out other awards to books for children and young adults. For example, the Coretta Scott King Award goes to African American writers and illustrators for books about African American culture. This year's award went to Rita Williams Garcia for her book, P.S. B11. The Robert F. Seibert Medal is for informational books. Parrots Over Puerto Rico by Susan Roth and Cindy Trumbore won the 2014 medal. Their book tells about how scientists and activists saved the local birds. Librarian Deborah Taylor says, the book shows Puerto Rico as it is not often seen. For VOA Learning English, I'm Carla Babb.